The only issue we have to deal with is continuity issue. That's it. Continuity issue is solved by us remembering what reality is, being reminded of what reality is. That's how it's solved. So we observe what reminds us of reality. Now, merely being the observer is not the answer. It's what you're observing that's the answer. We get all the spiritual teaching here says, be the observer, be the witness, be this. What are you observing? What are you witnessing to? If you're observing this world, you're not being reminded of reality at all. It's a complete waste of time. The remedy is to observe what reminds us of reality, which is the death-free realm, death-free experience. And we can have that death-free realm can actually shine into this realm as the overlay, as overlaying everything here. So it is possible in this world to observe the overlay of all the staging. The staging can become beautiful here. And we can simply observe that. And that will remind us of reality. Ultimately, the death-free realms give us a perfect reminder, flawless reminder of reality. So ultimately, we'll all go there. But I would say the intermediate step to getting there would, you could, in this world, you could observe the overlay, the staging becoming absolutely exquisitely beautiful. So it doesn't matter what the play on the stage is at all. That is the simple remedy. That is the practical remedy. That is what actually works. The difficulty in coming into this world, you can have the remedy. You can know what it is and forget it. Can you imagine that? You know the answer, you come in this world, and you forget what it is. How is that possible? Because this world is populated by aspects of spirit are here who are completely whimsical and eccentric. And I use these terms because they're non-derogatory terms. It's very important to start learning non-derogatory language. I'm trying to jettison the stuff like totally insane, totally crazy, ego, and all this stuff. No, aspects of spirit who have never left reality, imagining this hypothetical scenario as a contingency plan. And it's a completely whimsical, eccentric, extravagant, time-wasting situation. But that's non-derogatory. And it's more accurate, really. It's more accurate. Forget about the ego. Forget about the self, the non-self. All that stuff's archaic, actually. Very archaic way of looking at things. Very whimsical way. Because we only have one issue, and that's a continuity issue. Is this situation we're in is like total forgetfulness of reality. If you observe this world, you will totally forget reality, almost totally. It'll be so buried that you know, it's just like the faintest, flickering, tiny little flame somewhere, deep, buried. That's what happens when you observe this world. Observing this world is futility. Okay, so that this world doesn't help with the continuity issue at all. Doesn't help at all. Unless we allow the blessing of the other hypothetical of what if we didn't need any hypotheticals at all to shine into this, our perception of the world. And then it will help us, remind us of reality. But the issue of ego, of observer, self, all that archaic language is not even necessary, actually. The traditional language of non-duality, all this, it's not even necessary. It's archaic, actually. It's still very whimsical. You see, we're going from a situation of 99.99999% whimsicalness and eccentricity here to trying to drop all that. What happens is we try to make deals. We say, of course, if someone's in a completely whimsical state of mind, totally eccentric, when you say, here's the remedy, how are they going to receive it? In an eccentric way, of course. That's the problem here. You can be perfectly enlightened, come into this world, know what the answer is. Forget about enlightenment. You know the answer. That's more important. You're super pragmatic, super practical. You know what works. That's what's important. You know what works. You come here and you say, here it is. And they will take it in a completely bizarre way and they'll be completely eccentric with it. And so it doesn't work, of course. They'll say, oh, is this what you're giving? You hand something over to them, and they'll go, and you know, just like, and it is not, they don't take it just the way it is at all. So of course that's the problem here. It drives you nuts coming in here, trying to just, here's the simple remedy. It's very simple. And they cannot handle the practicality or simple remedy at all. As you would expect, if someone is entirely whimsical and eccentric to the utmost degree, how can you give them anything that isn't going to be turned into something absolutely bizarre? How? How is that possible? Therein lies the frustration, the problem. You see, it's not that the remedy is difficult at all. It's completely simple. Utterly simple and obvious. It's just exchange hypotheticals. Just exchange it. Just choose a new hypothetical and be reminded of reality. The only issue we have is to be reminded accurately of reality, truly reminded of it. So then the continuity issue is gone for us, and then we can easily set down all hypotheticals. Easy, simple, basic. Anybody could understand that, unless they were acting out an extraordinary whimsical and eccentric dream, right? And so in character, in that dream, they can't accept anything as it is. So you give them the truth and they'll turn it into some bizarre eccentricity. And that's happened. If I looking at the spiritual history of this planet as I have done, what I see is just incredible eccentricity. It's rubbish. Throw it all away. Throw it all away. You don't need any of it. The answer is so completely simple. What do you need all this eccentric heritage for? You don't need any of it. I don't feel like attached to the past, the spiritual past of this planet or any past of the planet. It's totally unnecessary. I spend a lot of time watching all the stuff, the various traditions, and to me, it's utterly bizarre, utterly bizarre. I was watching a documentary on Adi Shankaracharya yesterday, and the rituals and the things I did, to me, is totally bizarre, totally eccentric. It's just like I have no idea what they're getting at all. And that's my reaction to everything I witness. Whatever tradition, you take any religious tradition, whatever, and it's utterly bizarre to me. Extremely eccentric. It's the kind of thing that somebody who is totally whimsical and eccentric and bizarre and extravagant would come up with. That's what they'd come up with. So don't be attached to the spiritual heritage of the planet, the intellectual heritage, the heritage at all. It's nothing but the play, a completely bizarre play. The answer is just completely simple. Just exchange hypotheticals. I mean, I can lay it out so simply, and that's all you need. The only issue we have, the only problem we have is a continuity issue. That's it. No other problem whatsoever. The continuity issue is solved by being appropriately, clearly reminded of reality, what reality is, mirroring reality. A hypothetical that mirrors reality is what we need to be aware of. That solves a continuity issue. That's it. How do we get this experience of a hypothetical that mirrors reality? By choosing the hypothetical. What if, and there's what if we didn't need any hypotheticals? That would actually give us this mirroring experience of reality. And we have to exchange the hypothetical we have now. But what if reality could be annihilated? That's what we're entertaining now. To what if reality couldn't be annihilated? In other words, we don't need any contingency plan. Just exchange it. And that you go into the what's called the death-free realm. Your experience would be the death-free realm, which reminds us of reality. There's no death, no suffering, no vulnerability. We don't want to change anything. It's flawlessly beautiful. And that reminds us of reality. Simple. That's all there is to it. And then how do you get into the death-free realm? Then there's a little bit more that you need to add on. But once you have the basics, the other stuff is easy to get. Easy to get. So try, again, Jesus said, don't put new wine into old wineskins. What he's saying is, when you don't try to give the simple truth here and integrate it into all the bizarre eccentricity, the heritage of a bizarre eccentricity. When he came, he said, look, I'm bringing a new testament. I'm not trying to integrate everything I say into the Old Testament. I'm bringing a new testament. Anytime you bring truth into this world, it has to be a new testament. because you are faced with the spiritual heritage of this planet. And everybody's going to say, well, how does this integrate with what I already know? And the answer is, it doesn't integrate. You don't need to integrate it at all. So, and then people say, well, you, what kind of spiritual teacher are you? You're rejecting our heritage? You're not bowing at the feet of Buddha or Shankara or Jesus or whoever, you know? No, absolutely not. Because the heritage of those teachers has been put into a bizarre context. You see, I do bow at the feet of the actual teachers, the actual teaching, but not at the feet of the heritage of this planet, which is utterly bizarre. Totally, very, very eccentric about all this stuff, because it's missing the point. You know, how bizarre is it to miss the simple point? Something that's very simple. How eccentric is it to completely miss that and not think it's important that you even missed it or something? That's just, you know, very, very eccentric to do that. We don't realize that we're engaged in whimsy because the spirit is trying to become the prime creator, which is completely whimsical. And then it's realizing, uh-oh, if I do that, reality will be destroyed. And so I need a contingency plan to survive the annihilation of reality. Again, totally whimsical. It's totally eccentric, because reality cannot be changed. It cannot be destroyed. We cannot become prime creator. All that is nothing but pure whimsy. Pure whimsy. And so we are in this purely whimsical state. And so, of course, you want to convey something utterly practical, and it completely lost in the translation. Completely lost. So it's very frustrating. Like, and people who try to help end up becoming, trying to sort of sinking down into that eccentricity a little bit themselves. Very few have not done that. And the ones that don't, we think they're eccentric. We think they're, what's wrong with them? They're so eccentric. They're going around and say everything is perfectly, flawlessly beautiful. Of course, because they're seeing the overlay. The staging is all beautiful, which reminds them of reality. And they're just showing us, look, you can, even in this world, you can be reminded of reality if you accept this flawless, seamless overlay of all the staging. I mean, the staging meaning nature. And even here you can do this. But the best way is go to the death-free realm. And you don't need to die to go to the death-free realm. How can you enter the death-free realm if you believe you can die? That's not possible. It's important to note that the so-called afterlife, that's just a fantasy too, completely. And actually, that's a blue jay, first one I've seen in a long time. Hey, hello. A couple of them. So-called afterlife. The whole idea of existence is try to make death real and then survive it. So, of course, let's say we're dwelling in the so-called afterlife, but we've never gone down with bodies. And we imagine bodies. We're in a world, and then the body dies, and then we find ourselves in the afterlife. And we say, ah, you see, death is real, but we survived it. This is all the life, existence here on this planet, and then the afterlife, those are part of two sides of one coin. Utter fantasy. Utter fantasy. Totally eccentric fantasy. Could you imagine an afterlife in reality? Well, that's like saying, what is after reality? There's no such thing like that at all. So the remedy isn't to die and find yourself in the afterlife. That doesn't remind you of reality. That's an attempt to make death real and then say, hey, I survived death. Therefore, now I'm great. I have a contingency plan to survive the annihilation of reality, so now I can become prime creator. No, that's not the remedy. Remedy is to go to the death-free realm, which is simply a choice. Simply a choice. Simple choice. And we see this world and how terrible it is. And it is terrible, absolutely terrible. And we think, and it doesn't remind us of reality at all. So what's the usefulness of it? No usefulness. None. So why don't we just say, okay, let's choose a different dream. In other words, let's choose a different hypothetical scenario, a different dream. Just choose a different dream. One that reminds us of reality. This one doesn't at all. And yet we're so eccentric, we keep thinking, that it is reminding us of reality. No, it's reminding us of death. That's what this world reminds us of, is death. There's no death in reality. It's useless to use the world in that way. Totally useless. But if you try to teach this here, nobody gets it. Because the eccentricity is at play. Is at play. And it'll say, oh, they said it's green. Oh, they can't mean that. They must have meant it's blue. Like that. It's just, yeah, it's blue. Okay, they said they meant blue, but they said green. So I say, no, this world doesn't remind you of reality at all. And they say, oh, he meant to say it does remind you of reality. And what we need to do is completely get into this world and just observe it more and more and more. I say, no, that's not the remedy. They say, oh, he said, yes, it is the remedy. You know, completely twist it around. What can you do when you're dealing with that kind of eccentricity? What can a teacher do, really? What can a teacher do, you see? And then they blame it on the teacher. Say, oh, you didn't help me. What can you do when you're dealing with total eccentricity? Right? What happens is you start playing mind games, thinking you can somehow guide them into it and say, well, it's not really this, it's this, it's this. And then you end up getting all confused. That's the problem. It's really a very difficult problem. Even the best teachers here say, hey, you know, not many people really understood at all what I was here for. They didn't get it. Jesus said, you don't understand. He said to his apostles, you really don't get it. You know, you don't get it at all. So I'm trying to teach in parables and all this stuff, but you're really confused. You're talking about the apostles here. So that's exactly what happens. You come here, you try to tell the very simple remedy, and people just don't get it. And then you end up beating yourself up, thinking that, you know, you're somehow not doing everything you could do, which is not true. Look at Sri Anandamayi Ma, spent 86 years here, and constantly witnessing to the remedy, And she said, look, very few really came here for truth at all. And how many that came to her actually got it? I don't know. I haven't seen any, really. Maybe there's some here and there. I'm not aware of any. In other words, so even if you have a flawless example of the remedy, we still don't get it here. We still don't get it. And we veer off into all this completely bizarre stuff of the world. So... It's a really something. And I keep knocking myself out trying to, how do you get past eccentricity? See, that is the question. You don't. Because there's no constancy to it. There isn't. At any moment, they just, whoosh, gone, like that. Just off in a tangent like that. And they can simply say, well, this is what you really meant to say, and make it opposite or different. No matter what you say. And then you think you can trick them. So if, like, you say, listen, you just need to accept the death-free realm. And that's it. And they say, oh, you meant that you need to stay here in this death realm. Okay. And I say, no. I say, they reversed it. So let me reverse it. Say, no, you need to stay here in the death realm. And I think maybe they'll reverse it. And they'll say, oh, you said you need to stay in the death-free realm. But you see, you haven't made, there's no progress there. Because the eccentricity is still there, just reversing, twisting and reversing stuff and trying to, of course, do the impossible, which is to make spirit prime creator. So there's no way to deal with it in that way at all. There's no way to deal with it. So I beat myself up here in the world trying to find a way. There's, when you're dealing with total whimsy, there is no way. There is no way. The way turns out to be severe suffering for people, actually. when your whimsy leads you into this mental state of utter confusion, that's when the whimsy stops, begins to stop. Before then, you thought that you just caught up in so much whimsy, you don't know, you have no way of really focusing on any truly practical remedy. but what actually works, because you're looking for what can never work. But when the suffering gets too terrible, then you say, whoa, wait a minute, I've got to change. Something fundamentally is wrong, and I've got to find out what it is. And then you get on the spiritual path, and then it is possible to hear the simple remedy. But I've heard it for years and years and years and years, and still the eccentricity of the world gets you to forget. Because what is more eccentric? If you have the remedy right in your hand, what is more eccentric than to forget that you have it right in your hand? See, that's very eccentric. The whole world, the remedy is right here, and the whole world is not even pretending like they have not the slightest clue. Not the slightest clue what to do. So you get caught up in yourself saying, hey, I don't have a clue either what to do. And then it's like, what? How did that happen? God. Oh, Lord. So that's how it is here. That's how it is here. Dangerous place to come into here. When you go into an insane asylum, it's a very dangerous thing. Because you'll start to try and help, and you'll start role-playing, and you get caught up in it yourself, trying to maneuver somebody towards this, to the exit, so to speak. And, of course, that's the one thing they reject. A priori rejection of what works. Because what works will remind them that reality works. Reality is as it is, and spirit can't become prime creator. So the last thing that's this idea, this hypothetical, wants to entertain is truth. That's the last thing. So of course they're going to avoid it at all costs. Avoid the truth and say, well, we're working to change the world. We're working to change this world. Of course, there's nothing in this world that reminds us of reality. The more we try to change the world, the more we forget reality, because reality doesn't need to be changed. If you're looking at something that you want, it needs to be changed, you're forgetting reality entirely. So the whole notion of changing this world, making it better, just makes it worse. Just makes it worse, actually. The whole situation gets worse. Now it's become more and more whimsical. Say, no, we're going to make this world appear to remind us of reality. We can do it. We can build all these buildings and plant all these parks and do all these beautification. The more we do that, the more we forget reality, because reality is a situation we don't need to change anything. So in order to be reminded of reality, you have to be in an environment where you have the slightest desire to change anything. And it's just and you see that's always been this way. It's not like you fixed it or made it that way. It's always been this way. The death-free realm has always been the way it is. Utterly exquisite and beautiful. And you don't feel like you need to change anything. Absolutely not. There's no harm, no evidence of harm. Then you just abide in that, and that reminds you of reality. But in this world, here we are desperately trying to reconfigure change. Just makes it worse. It's just more expression of our whimsy. All right. I don't have to go, see? Okay. All right. Well, so it is possible if you have really suffered in this world. If you really suffered, you've been sick, you've been suffered, you know, really stuff that really teeth really got into you. The world really got into teeth. You felt it and you said, you know what? Wow. I want to sober up. There's something wrong. Then you do have a chance. You do have a chance. That's what happened with me. But I came in with some clarity, which a lot of us do. And then you get caught up in this whimsicalness and you lose your way. You can't handle it here. And then you really suffer terribly, 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 terribly. That then enables one to realize that there's something really screwy about this world, and there's something, you know, that this, the world's just is so eccentric, and you start looking for answers. But the problem is, you look into the spiritual heritage of the planet, seeking, well, can I find it in this tradition? This, no, because again, all traditions in this world are heavily, heavily, heavily pulled down into extreme. Eccentricity. Really? Good grief. You can't get it that way. has to be fresh. Has to be ultimately your own freshness of seeing, freshly, your own seeing, which is the most fresh. And then those of us who are here, who are able to help some giving it fresh, very fresh. You cannot, anything that enters into this world very quickly is spun into all sorts of eccentricities, and you have all these spiritual tea parties and spiritual fashion shows, and everything becomes eccentric so quickly. The eccentric grab a hold of it and then spin it out in eccentric fashion. A Course in Miracles, that's already happened. I look at the way A Course in Miracles, it has been spun out into the world, very eccentric and bizarre and whimsical from my standpoint. I just have to shake my head and say, my gosh, that's extraordinarily eccentric, the way that it's being spun out into the world. And from those who want to keep the answer from being seen, actually, they don't. They're still way, very much in their cups of eccentricity. So it's important to get it really fresh, really fresh. No dogma, not dogmatic. Which is why the teachers that are effective are the ones that come up with something really, really fresh right now, not dogmatic, and you can feel the potency of it, the clarity of it. That's what's important. And then the tradition comes up, you know, that makes it very, very difficult. So you make it fresh for yourself and work on it. That's how you make it fresh. Again, just reading dogma, that's not going to do it. It's not going to do it. We think that's the shortcut. And all we got to do is, let me go down to a bookstore and get some book, and I'll just read it, and okay. Or, no. That's not fresh. You have to get your own insights, have to arise within you. And you see the immediate fresh clarity of them, and you say, wow, this is it. And then you realize how you go off on a tangent, and you say, oh my gosh, the eccentricity is still, you know, gripping me, and I need to get back to the freshness of it. And you have to do it that way. Some try to do it with chanting, which is possible. That I can see how that's possible, but it cannot just be mechanical chanting. You have to freshly repeat the clarity over and over and over, and that sort of burns away the eccentricity, as it were. But that's not easy. That is not easy, to continually express freshness over and over. But it is possible. There are lots of paths that are possible, but they have to be fresh for you. They have to be fresh. They have to have, you have to feel the clarity. You have to be immerse yourself in it and burn away the eccentricity. You have to. There's no other way, because we are truly, in a way, we are trapped. People, I feel that it's called in this world, because everyone's saying we're trapped. Please help us. And in a way, we are trapped in our own eccentricity. And that is a trap, actually. Because we, it's not that we're insane. Because when we say insane, we figure there's a path to sanity or something. With eccentricity, there's no path at all. There's no path. The only thing that does it is a true repentance, as it were. It's called, Jesus said, you have to repent in order to get in the kingdom of heaven. Meaning, you have to make a decision that you are going to iron out the problem, as it were, and that's it. That's the only issue you have in life is you are truly going to resolve this situation and succeed at it. And you know that there's something drastically wrong, and you're going to overcome that situation. It's repentance, and that usually comes from severe suffering or severe depression. Something that realizes, hey, this is just, it's not going to work. This eccentricity just isn't going to work. And then you, from that standpoint, you get some leverage. You get a glimpse of reality, which happened to me. You get leverage, and you start using the leverage, and you start prying away the eccentricity, etc. But that still doesn't solve how to help others. And the fact is, you really, your ability to help others is actually kind of limited because of the eccentricity. So ultimately, there is the suffering does bring people to shed this eccentricity. That's what Ananda Maima said. She says the greatest path to God is through suffering. It's about the only path, actually, which is true. It's a true statement. It's a true statement. Because without suffering, the eccentricity will just continue on. There's no leverage over it. There's no leverage over it. Where leverage? One who's given over to total eccentricity, total whimsy. Where's the leverage? There's none. They're just playing aimless wandering around. There's no leverage at all. But when the suffering really gets to you, then you start having some leverage. So in some ways, the great teachers say that God brings great suffering upon us. That's a metaphor. God is not bringing any suffering on us at all, really. But as it were, that our eccentricity does lead us into great suffering. Because we're so eccentric, we try to entertain mutual exclusives simultaneously, which is the very height of eccentricity, and that causes mental suffering so extreme that we finally say, hey, this isn't going to work. This ultimate eccentricity, that's no way does that work. And so we realize the whole thing doesn't really work at all. And then we start shedding all of that. But really, that's all that can be done. So what I generally see is the people who have really suffered in their lives are the ones who have really made the progress on the path. Those who've been sick. If you're sick when you're young, that really is a shocker. You stay sick for a long time. You're really down. You're depressed. All these things that really, really severe suffering of the deepest kind, that is what turns the tide here. But as far as trying to teach here, my gosh, the greatest teachers in history have really gotten almost nowhere with their teaching. So how can you expect anybody to get anywhere, really? You cannot. You cannot. So for me, I have to somehow forgive myself for the failing, you know, to do what I hoped I could do, which is to just tell the simple truth, because it simply runs into the buzzsaw of this eccentricity and turns it into sawdust. Turns it into sawdust, absolutely. And even if you witness to the truth, people will think, oh, they'll delve in, goes on the buzzsaw and turns into sawdust. They'll think that it's coming from some completely different origin, or you know, they won't understand the explanation. They'll turn it into something, some other explanation that fits with their eccentricity. You see, any explanation you give has to fit in with their eccentricity, that they say it has to fit. Has to fit in. So of course it's going to be twisted in bizarre ways. This is not it at all. And you can give it out a million times, and a million times it'll be twisted. That's the nature of the situation here. So unfortunately, it's not really possible to spare people suffering. It's not really possible. Except those who already have suffered and who really want to get free of suffering. It is possible to help those get free of suffering. It is. There is some way to help here. But you can't help everybody, really. Maybe in a very minimal way. Just sort of a vague, obscure way that they sort of get this vague impression, like something that eventually helps burn off the fog, as it were, the obscurity. But as far as, you know, really getting them to the death-free realm, so no, that's not possible. So these are the kind of things that actually help you most, that are just seeing. Drop the naivete about the world, see the practicality, recognize that there's only so much you can do here, actually. That's a bitter lesson, very bitter. Because if you've given your whole life to try and find a way, and you realize there is no way, really, to make that much, to be that helpful here, that's a tough one. Very tough one. So that must be what I'm struggling with right now. And that's probably the toughest one of all. Because, of course, you, if you have the cure, and all these people are just suffering so terribly, and you say, here's the cure, and they give it to them, like, let's say you had a pill. Now, if you take this pill, you're cured. And they say, oh, great, great. So you give them the pill, and what do? They throw it in the lake. I said, what'd you do? He said, oh, you told me to throw it in the lake. I said, no, I didn't. I said, take the pill, and you threw it in the lake. And they said, no, you told me to throw it in the lake. So I said, okay, let's do this again. So I give him the pill. I said, okay, now, take the pill, put it in your mouth, swallow the pill. That's what you do, see? And they say, oh, okay. And they drop it on the ground, and they stomp into powder, and then pew, pew, pew. And they say, you told me to stomp it on the ground, turn it to powder so the wind could blow it away. And I said, no, I said to take it. They say, no, you didn't. You didn't say that. So, what do you do? What do you do? What do you do? What do you do? Very great. That's it.